subject today is God the greatest scientist? So it's a very intriguing subject, and we have two minds who are experts in their own field. Mr. Nanda, as you know, was secretary and principal secretary in Gujarat government, and Anand Meghanandan is very, very successful novelist who has sold lakhs of copies of books, and he is of the point of view that gods actually were kings in the olden ages, and as they became modern, we elevated them to gods. Whereas Mr. Nanda is a great devotee of Lord Jagannath of Puri, and he himself is from Puri. And I am going to moderate the session, so I will start by asking Mr. Nanda, can you explain about the cult of Jagannath to the audience?
Before I thought I should talk about the Jagannath cult, I wanted to straight come to the topic. Then my other co-partner will take over. He is a God scientist. Friends, when Darwin came out with the theory of evolution, he said that evolution is a process of change. It is a process of change. He has never denied that there is no role of God as an agent in change. He says so. It is by choice or by design, is not known, but definitely it's a change. That's all he said. So when we ask questions, why blood is red? Why trees are there? Why oceans are there? Is there any evidence of the fact that there was a maker of that? There's no evidence, it's an experience. So the same way, I just wanted to mention that the science believes in taking bodies as pillars for their research. The scriptures of faith which we have, they also take models as fathers, mothers, husbands, lovers. They also are there. They're based on what? They're based on the relations of the gods and the goddesses. The gods' relations is copied by the human beings on earth. The relations of the god, I'm talking Hindu pantheon. Whenever we talk of Vishnu, we talk of Lakshmi, we talk of Jagannath, we talk of Balbhadra, we talk of Ram, Shiv, Durga. It's the context of family we talk. So the model that we follow is the model of the scripture model, the faith as the model. The science, when you go for the discovery, they also take some postulates. But science says that the planets are there and they do their further research. But science does not go into the area who is the person who took the planets into motion. Can any scientist say which one, who is the author, or who is the fellow, or who is the patron for keeping the planets in motion? No one. People know there are 22 billion microbes in the world. Scientists say, biologists, what they say. But who created the microbes? The botanists, they don't say. That's it. The scientists talk of global warming. But climate change was there always throughout the centuries. You know, when Dante, the famous writer, wrote the books, people died of so much of cold in European that half of the European population was famished, ravished in the cold. In those years of 1300 to 1400, when Dante wrote the book, so there was a, so you can say it's a climate change. The climate change was always there. The global warming is no doubt the scientific fact, there is no doubt about the fact, but climate change has been happening. So it's a process of evolution, it's a process of emergence, it's a process of the factor that someone is the mover, shaker. Someone is an invisible hand, and something is there which makes the world to go according to some laws of nature. Those laws of nature are not known to the brain. Those laws of nature have not been identified. When Newton discovered, he says that it is only one drop. The rest of the ocean is yet to be discovered. So that one drop and rest of the ocean to be discovered is the square of what we are not able to square up, and we put it as something uncanny, mysterious, universal ego, universal being, the maker, the destroyer, and that we call the God. Now, question Mr. Modi asked was the Jagannath cult. The Jagannath cult is a cult which came up basically to make people feel that they are equal. When caste distinctions were at its height, when Varna system was at its height, when Brahmins and other non-Brahmins never used to have that equanimity and equality in the society, Jagannath cult came as a cult where it started saying that all of you are to look at my eyes. So the eyes are round. And if you want to have any redressal, come and see me in my own temple, because I don't have hands nor legs to walk. You have to come with your legs and hands to walk up to me. If you express your confidence and faith in me, I will prevail in you. This is the concept of the Jagannath cult. And if you see, the color of the Jagannath is black, the color of Subhadra is black, the yellow, and the color of the younger brother Balabhadra is white. It's a cosmic religion where three races, white, yellow means we, and black means Africa and the Caribbean. All the continents are covered. So it's a universal God. Another point, the tribals used to worship the gods, animistic gods, pillars, snakes, trees, logs, wood. Jagannath is made not of any metal, not of any marble. It is made out of wood. Why? Wood is considered as living being. So it's a living God. And the Adivasis, they always worship living things, never non-living things. And because the Adivasis used to worship snakes, the facial features of Jagannath that you see is not squarish. It is something like a snake hood. It's something like a snake hood which is looking at the topmost portion of the wood carving. So you feel that there is a mixture of the serpentine bent in the wooden structure. So they have tried to assimilate also the animistic world of the society and make it a universal God.
Thank you. Now, before I start asking Mr. Meghanandan about his rationalistic view about is God a scientist, I'd like to share a simple story which is taken from my book Learning Through Stories about the existence of God. One day, a small child goes to Mount Kailash, and where Lord Shiva is meditating, and he asks his mother, who is in the village, that can I ask a question to this Lord Shiva? So what the mother says, mother, don't call him a man because he is God. He knows the answer to every question in this universe. So the boy is very naughty. He says, does he know every question, answer to every question in physics, mathematics, geography? Mother says, yes. So the child thinks he will go and outsmart Lord Shiva by proving he is not a God. So how will he do that? He goes to the garden, catches a butterfly and holds it cup in his hands behind. And he thinks he will ask Lord Shiva, is the thing in my hand alive or dead? So what does the child think? If Lord Shiva answers that the thing is dead, he will leave the butterfly, it will fly away, so it's alive. And if Lord Shiva answers it is alive, he'll crush the butterfly in his hand and show that it is dead. So both the answers, Lord Shiva is wrong. So then obviously he gives the wrong answer to the question. So thinking this, the child goes up the mountain, catches a butterfly, holds a cup in his hand, holds it, hides it behind his back and asks, Lord Shivaji, Lord Shivaji, you know the answer to every question in this universe? Can you just tell me whether the thing in my hand, is it alive or dead? So Lord Shiva opens his eyes and replies, my dear son, the answer lies in your hands. જવાબ તમારી હાથમાં છે. તો કહેવાનો મતલબ એ છે કે is God the greatest scientist? The answer is in your hands. And I also now ask Mr. Neelakantan to explain to me that how did the kings of Ramayana, Lord Rama, became a god and is being worshipped by millions of Hindus?
Good afternoon. Am I audible? It is a chicken and egg story. This debate keeps on continuing whether God is there, God is sentient, God is there or not. It's an inconclusive question. But making him say that, have you ever seen a scientist using some scriptures to prove his theory? Have you ever seen any scientist quoting any scriptures to prove his theory? He doesn't do that. It is only the religiously inclined who try to use science to desperately prove that their theory is right. It just shows the insecurity. Sir was telling, with all due respect, I have not mixed word, but all respect is there, sir. Darwin never talked about whether there is a change is made by an intelligent designer or not. No, Darwin is very clear that the change happens by itself. And if you see in our, if you want to go to scriptures, we will go to our own scriptures where this theory comes. Not on this one. It is more towards in Sakya, in Jaina theory, this theory of Svabhava. Svabhava is nature. Everything happens because of its nature. There is no need for a creator. That is why these are called agnostic or atheist religion, like Jainism. Part of many out of the six system of philosophy, three are agnostic. Buddhism is agnostic. India is a birthplace of agnostic religion. Agnostic religion says it is all Svabhava. It happens. There is no need for creator. It is only after the Bhakti cult came that we started assigning a creator, which is the, and the Bhakti cult, if you see, the Bhakti cult came when India started having contacts with the Semitic religions, like Islam or Christianity, where there is a creator God. Even in Advaita, there is no creator God. There is no God. There is no person who sits and judges. There is no judgmental God. There is no creator God in either in science or in ancient Indian philosophy. It is only in Bhakti cult this comes. I am not saying this is right or wrong, but coming back to this question, is there a need for God? Is the first question. It is like asking, God might be required for people if somebody is blind, he may need a stick. So you cannot criticize them, it is their need. So for the people who need that, God is required. Because this is a source of strength. There is nothing to criticize. But the problem comes when the people who are blind, who are using the stick of God, they insist that even the people whose eyes are open, they also should use the stick, close their eyes and walk around. There lies the problem. So there is no problem anybody wanting to have the stick. Let them have the stick. It is with all respect, let them have it, let them enjoy the stick. Those who don't have want it, they don't need it. Science doesn't depend on God. Science doesn't need God. God needs science. And before that, something? What is the God of today? You call it anything. The God of today is the God of ignorance. God always has been ignorant. And it may be an approachable statement to me. But initially, when the ancient man saw the lightning, he called it God, he called it Paul, he called it Indra. He called various names. Then slowly science developed. So he understood, no, that is not the God, it's a manifestation. So when this knowledge increases, like that, one by one, it was eliminated. This is God, this is the stone was God, this was God, that was God. Then finally, we have come to a stage where now, how do the God proponents deal with it? They say it's all symbolism. But God himself somewhere. Can you prove it? No, it is on you to prove it. No, sorry sir. If you have a claim, then it is for you to prove it and not for the people who say it is not there. You cannot prove a thing which is not there. Can you prove a thing which is not there? It is like saying you have heard of the flying spaghetti monster theory. In US and all, this is what they use to counter the creationists. Like how India is divided between this Aryan Dravidian theory. It's a perpetual theory. Nobody is going to agree on that. Whatever proof comes. Whether there was an alien question or not. Same in US, the biggest theory is whether there was a creation or whether there is the evolution. This is the biggest debate happening. So in US, what they do is they tell the flying spaghetti monster theory. In south of India, there is a new cult which has come called Dingan. Dingan is a rat. So there is a cult of what you call the people who are making fun of big time believers, saying that our God is this rat. Now, it is on you to prove that this rat doesn't exist. You prove it. You prove there is no flying spaghetti monster. I am saying it is between. It is there somewhere in the universe. You cannot see it. And whatever is happening, it is happening. I am talking like this because flying spaghetti monster built that. He wants me to talk like this. You are sitting here because he built that. You prove it. It is not. You can never prove it. Can you prove it? You can never prove it. So what happens, as the science progresses, as one by one, even now, we have only reached, as he rightly said, as I couldn't go that 350 years before. But even though we have reached 5% of the top knowledge, or 3% of the top knowledge, we done. But the science is the quest of knowing that knowledge. Science is the quest of an open mind. It doesn't conclude. Here what is there, first you have concluded there is God. Then you run around trying to fit theories into that. To prove that there is God, no, this is not it. Beat people, kill people, rape people, riot people, my God, your God, this God, that God. Have you ever seen anybody who is an agnostic? Why India was very peaceful? Because India had always this agnostic. Even in Vedas it says, what is Brahma? Maybe, Upanishad, maybe, this is not, it's a constant quest. It is so scientific, the British intelligence is so scientific. Only in Bhaktivinoda people are very sure, this is my God, he is my protector, it is his will, it will happen. It is nothing wrong in that, it is just the blind man's state. So you have to sympathize only, and you have to help them only, but they should not insist that you also, whose eyes have been opened, they should not insist that they also should hold the state and walk blind back to back with them, and to wherever you go. That's all I ask.
He has been our friend again. Talking of the nature, in the swabhava of nature is something which itself has to be thought further rationally. When God creates human being, you would say biologically it is from him because of the API cells and the other things being formed. That's a process you are talking. All over the world, all the children are having the fur, the organs in the single architecture. Two eyes, two nose, two parts of nose, two ears, all organs, all over the world, universally. Correct, proof. You cannot have any debate on that. Isn't it? All human beings, Homo sapiens, look alike. 400 crores, 500 crores people look alike. architecture is one, civil engineering inside the body, the mechanical engineering within the body, the chemical engineering to the brain and neurological cells in the body, the neurotransmitters in the body. I am talking of scientific language. All are alike. If all are alike, all are true, proven true since 1000 years, then who is the maker of that? The design is one, huh? CPU may be different, but the software is one. The CPUs are Mr. Kohli, Mr. Thomas, these are the CPUs, the hardware. The software is one. That software is passing through different across the nations, across the ages, across the centuries, across every regional climb and time. There we say that when these people are having what they are needing to grow, proteins, you will explain, they need proteins to grow, they need cells to grow, they need the carbohydrates to survive in terms of science. So, but when I will ask in terms of the elements, the five elements of earth are ingrained in fire, water, air, ether, these are the parts of his, an earth are a part of his livelihood or his life. So when he is burnt, nothing remains. Panchatattva goes. But you try to dissect it by saying that these are the cells, these are the chromosomes, these are the proteins, these are the growth centers and other things. You are describing the process only. You are not trying to question the source. I ask question that 22,000 million of microbes exist on earth. And without that, agriculture is not possible. Without that, crops are not possible. Without that, forests are not possible. Okay? Now, oxygen is given by trees and carbon dioxide is given out by, is taken by the trees. Universally true everywhere across the world. Who has made trees? You are having species of trees separately. Chandra is different, tick is different. You are only trying to do a dissection of the tree section. But who has made the trees? How trees are dotting the earth? What is the duty of the trees? As it is not supplying oxygen. Have you made any artificial oxygen in the laboratory so far? Have you made any artificial blood in the laboratory so far? You can have plastic money, plastic cards, ATM cards, but you have plastic blood to replace blood. You have plastic trees to replace trees, which can give you oxygen, which can take away the carbon dioxide. The scientists start with that. Trees are there. They are having oxygen, they are taking the CO2 out, they are taking it from you. That is a premise. Science believes in premise, what we call postulating. It starts on hypothesis. And hypothesis, if it is proved, it is science. Here, the hypothesis and the result are one. Number one, what do you call evidence or proof? I call it experience. Most of the people, those who go to temples, have you ever seen God? Has God called you, given an invitation card properly? How? Yet you go, what goes to movie? Experience, feeling, faith, hope, attaining sensation, a mind, regimentation in your mind, wrongly or rightly, that makes you move to the temple. So faith makes you move in the world. What is that? Experience. You experience it. When thousands of people experience the same feeling throughout, science says it is evidence. If I give you this water and your headache is gone, even if it is not the medical water which is having to eat, saying that the air, but you get healing. The whole house gets healing. And you have the experience of being healing. I have to go to the laboratory to ask that my water is very good for you. No. your experience is my evidence. You got my point? Your experiencing the point phenomena is evidencing for me. So that is exactly the point with which I wanted to start, that the things which we are discovering, which we are inventing, are things which are already there but not understood by us. Most of the Nobel Prize winners, if you see the biographies of, and go to Google and ask it, all Nobel Prize winners who are doing biophysics, astrophysics, biomimics, they write, more we have gone into the details of things, more we find that there is some unhidden and things which we are not able to answer. So they find that there is a way, but they come through to something which they have discovered. The certain things they are not able to discover. When we call a Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwar, Brahma is the creator, again the science. Vishnu is the operator, again the science. Shiva is the destroyer, again the science. That's called innovation in science. Innovation is that a new theory will supplant in the old theory. Evolution will take place, change will take place, dialectics will take place, thesis, antithesis, synthesis. This is the law of nature. So, but law of nature is made by whom? Which is written by Parliament? It is enacted by the Parliament in heaven, Kingdom of God. It is something given to you. You have not understood it, you call it law of nature. You call it law of human beings, you call it the natural law, you call it the supernatural law, you call it the being and the becoming, you call it the dualism and the monism. Names you may give, but the aims are the same. So therefore, I subscribe to the theory, the invisible hand is there, the visible hand, the visible mind, the cognitive mind is able to read some of them, discover some of them, and bring some revolution in the human beings, take the science forward, but that's not enough. Otherwise, the natural phenomena which you are seeing across the world is not explainable only by global warming, only by earthquakes and the tsunamis. Tectonic forces are there below the earth. It can happen even today, but it is happening at an alternative thing. No one can predict when the earthquake will take place. No scientist in the world can predict how much of rainfall India will have. No one will predict the cyclone will not come or will just come. If today we are able to predict cyclone will not come, earthquake will not happen here, or this will not happen there, excepting through faith, then we will be able to say that science dominates something called supernatural or the natural.
Have you ever experienced it? A drug addict says that, have you taken cocaine? You say no. He says you have to experience it. You take cocaine, you see heaven. Have you experienced it? If it is experience, that is science. You take cocaine. Thousands, lakhs of cocaine addicts have experienced it. Is that experience true? The legend is that cocaine. What is the difference between the argument of an alcoholic, the argument of a drug addict, and the argument of a religious fanatic? In the same scientist say, it is the same part of the brain which gets stimulated in all these kind of nasha, in all these kind of religion, whether it is drugs, whether it is alcohol, it is the, what is happening is delusion. So sir was telling about experience. Drug addiction also is an experience. They will also be the same theory. They also will say, what is your problem when we are having drug? We are getting a lot of satisfaction. We get better peace. Ask an alcoholic, he will say, I get better peace. If I don't go to temple, if I don't go to church, if I don't go to the mosque, my hands shiver because that call is happening. Same thing, alcohol also tells the same thing. If I don't have this, my hands will shiver. Because why? It is because as per science, it is affecting the same brain cell. So the experience is no proof. experience is my experience. That is why in India it has always been Atman Vaishnava. There is no cult. Cults are all which came later. It is, and science is what? Science is also a quest. Science never claims we have found everything. Science is a search. So you cannot say science doesn't have answer. Of course science doesn't have answer. Science didn't have answer how to fly 100 years before. And all the planes, all everybody is telling them, go on and circular, explain me. Then science broke it. So, again, the God went to hide in the ignorance, where the science has not reached, where the light of science has not reached. So it's a constant science is driving God. Now, if you see for the last 2000 or 1500 years, God doesn't come down and say, why are no new avatars happening? Why there is no new avatar? Why there are no prophets? Why God is not telling to Moses or somebody like that, X, Y, Z, that do this, do that, and he comes and says, you sacrifice your son, or do this, do that. Why nothing is happening? Because the light of science has come. The light of rationality has come. In India, Buddha brought it long back, but we lost it. Mahavira brought it, we lost it. Even up to an extent, Shankara brought it, we lost it. Why? Because the cult of, like all religion, the cult of priests took it over for exploitation. So, this became a business. Bhakti became a business. Devotion became a business. Temples became a business. And we lost the rationality. The moment we lost the rationality, we lost everything. We lost all wars. Every Tom, Dick, and Harry roaming around, he invaded us and conquered us.
Okay, so, we are running short of time.
Okay.
I'd like to
this is an independent debate. It will never over. Never be over. Thank you very much. For, I am not telling any popular thing. Most people are devotees, I know. But this is just my humble attempt. That's all. Thank you.
See, there is a story about Baba. If you want to know anything in the town, you go to the Baba. My Baba shop and Baba have the habit of talking to all their clients. So one day, a person goes to a Baba shop and start talking to the Baba. So Baba says, you know, God does not exist. So the devotee asks the Baba, why does God not exist? He says, if there was God, there would have been not so much of poverty in India, there would not be so many people dying, so many children are dying of malnutrition. Everything would have been fine, you know. Everything would have been fine and the world would have gone on if there was God. Because there is no God, there is so much of poverty, there is so much of death, there is so much of anger, there is so much of destruction. So, you know what the man says? The man quietly goes out of the shop and goes outside and researches, you know, among the people. There is a man with a long beard and a long hair, so he's not washed it for so many months and he's eating from a dustbin. So, he catches that man. Takes it to the barber and tells the barber, barbers do not exist, barbers do not exist, barbers do not exist. The barber comes out of his shop and says, are you mad? I am a barber and I exist. He says, if a barber existed, then such a man would not exist then with such a long hair. It is not that God does not exist, it is because people don't go to God, there is so much of poverty, there is so much of this, so much of pain in the world. Now, there are two ways of looking at this, but I want to have a question for Mr. Neelakantan. I have been to Kailash Mansarovar twice. Kailash Mansarovar is the holy place in China, which is Tibet. And whenever you go to Kailash, you can either go on foot from India, which takes 30 days. So, he told that Buddhism is an agnostic religion and doesn't believe in God. So, when you go to Kailash, there is a place in between which is known as Milarepa's cave. I don't know how many of you heard of Milarepa. Milarepa was a Buddhist cave. Now whenever the car, that when you drive to Kailash, it reaches Milarepa's cave, the Buddhist driver, who is wearing the mala and chanting the Buddhist cave, he stopped the jeep and he told me, Mr. Menon, get down. I said, what happened? Have we reached Kailash? He said, no, we have not reached Kailash, but we have reached Milarepa's cave. So I said, okay, what's so special about Milarepa? He says, anyone who drinks water from this cave will become enlightened. So So I said, okay, let's go and drink water. So we got down and we went into a cave, and in the cave there is a rock. On the rock there is a palm tree, which scientists are not able to explain. There is the five fingers of Milarepa there. So you touch that palm tree with your palm and then you take the water and drink. I would like to ask Mr. Milarepa, how do you explain Milarepa's palm tree and why millions of Buddhists are going there and praying there?
I will ask you one thing, did you get enlightenment to drink the water? Did you get enlightenment?
Yes, I did. I actually did.
So, can you explain what is enlightenment? This is enlightenment?
I tell you what is enlightenment. Enlightenment is when you actually know that you are a soul. And after that Kailash visit, I actually realized that I was a soul. And actually that happened. So though it is a Buddhist cave, but the water is a natural thing, and everybody who goes to Kailash, I recommend you to go to Milarepa's cave.
I think poor Buddha didn't know that. Poor fellow was of the Bodhi tree. He would have just gone to the pass and got enlightenment by drinking one bottle of water. This is how priests tell religion. I never said Buddhism is an agnostic religion. I said Buddha is an agnostic. There is a huge difference between Buddhism. There is a huge difference between Christ and Christianity. There is a huge difference between Krishna and what people did with Krishna. That is precisely the point I am making. But people are selling enlightenment on Bisleri bottles. What could be more ridiculous than this? Bisleri bottle enlightenment. And what is it? You drink that, you get enlightenment. Wow. And can any scientist disprove that? Is this a scientist's duty? Scientists have a lot of better things to do in life. Scientists created all these things. Your electricity, your microphone, your mobile phone. Will they go and check each track will say this, to touch this you will get enlightenment, to stand like this you will get Brahma, and you ask scientist duty is to go and disprove all these things, then they will be doing only this. So this is, when I started I asked, has any scientist said that my theory of relativity is correct because Bible says that? No, he doesn't want that. He uses intellect, he uses rationale to prove it. Only the religious people who are insecure, they will catch hold of science and say that no, this is as per some scientific theory. Dashavatara is Darwin. We have predicted Darwin. How is Dashavatara Darwin's theory? Let me understand. What is Dashavatara? When we make this kind of ridiculous claims, when we say Ganapati is plastic surgery, Shiva did plastic surgery, for a minute you get shocked because it is against common sense. There is no doubt Sushruta had done the primitive plastic surgery. Which you have to be proud of. That doesn't mean you tell any kind of claim. When I told the story to my 10-year-old boy, he was laughing because he is not concerned with religion. So he asked me, if I get an elephant, can I get an elephant head? Because his next size is this. Even a baby elephant's next size will be this. So how will you do that? Without any rationality, and then we say, why see we have predicted plastic surgery? Dashavatara, Matsya, Purma, is it Darwin's theory? First Matsya comes, then Purma comes, then Varaha comes, then Narasimha comes, Vamana comes. But how come this is Darwin's theory? It means neither Dashavatara we are right, nor Darwin's theory we are right. It is just a childish correlation. It is a pattern seeking in your brain. Like we see, in the cloud there is an elephant. The Airavata is something, we have predicted that. So this kind of prediction it is. There is no science, and science is quite open. There is nobody stopping you. Another theory which we keep hearing is that we had a lot of science, the Westerners took everything away and then they discovered everything. What were you doing with that until then? Sitting on it? Eating it? So this theory we keep on telling, this all comes from our inferiority complex. We lost 200 years when the Renaissance happened in Europe, we were in darkness. We had a golden age. We were sunk by the priests. We were sunk by the cults. And we, when Europe was in dark ages, we were much more rational. We were much more far developed. India and China were far developed. This is historically true. But later stage, all these kind of pseudo theories started coming. And all these kind of cults, priests, this thing, that thing came coming. And they completely sunk our culture and religion, and we were doomed in the eternal darkness. You see, it was all
I just wanted to mention here, again at the cost of repeating myself, that there is some universal force. You name it by any name. You name it as accident, you name it as bodily, vegetable, anything body. There is some universal force which connects the object and the subject, which connects the soul and the transmigration, which connects the human being with the nature. We are not able to see, nor people have discovered it, does not mean that science is gone. Science is hidden. But some people, they feel it. And that is the reason why in the Bhagavad Purana, which is said, he said, why it is not happening, no avatar is coming. Avatar will not come in next, I won't get to come in years. Because they have said, their predictions in the last chapter of the Bhagavad Purana, that people will run after wealth, family relations will crush, the thieves will dominate, the elderly will be left out, there will be absolutely artificial ways of living, spiritualism would be symbolism, yes, your spiritualism will go away. It's the last chapter of the Bhagavad Purana, writes this until this Kali Yuga does not end. Then the avatara will come. You will not be there, he will not be there. In case we get the rebirth, will come back.
Sir, this kind of task offered, this kind of predictions is very easy to make because it is human nature. People will fight for property. Dwaparayuga, Mahabharata happened. Were they fighting for spiritual enlightenment? They were fighting for property, for Hastinapura. Were they fighting for spiritual? Their brother was fighting brother. That kind of war, they were not fighting. Only enemy countries are fighting. So, in Dwaparayuga, they were fighting. And the Bhagavan was telling you fight. Okay, and because of property war, let us not kid ourselves, because of property war they were fighting. For the kingdom, they were not fighting for any spiritual enlightenment, which easily they could have got by drinking the water in Kila Pass or wherever. They were not doing that. So this is a prediction which is very easy to make because it's human nature. That will be true 1,000 years before, that will be true 10,000 years before, that will be true 10,000 years hence also. So that is what I said, it is swabhava, it is nature.
Mahavrata is not yoga. Mahavrata is not a yoga. Mahavrata is a philosophy. What is the difference between Ramayana and Mahavrata? Ramayana teaches the art of the state, like the concept of state.
Mahavrata,
Dwapara
Yuga, it happened in
Dwapara
Yuga. Correct. You are telling in Kali Yuga people will fight, I am saying Dwapara Yuga also people fought.
People fought, not because of the property. The rulership is your bad quality people, they have been exterminated. The ruler of the state is a useless act. And the rulers continue this 100 corrupts will continue. It will finish the whole state. So in the interest of the people, they have to be killed by the five people. That is the concept that is.
Sir, Duryodhana was saying that time also you existed, you will exist now, you will exist tomorrow, both will exist. It is swabhava, human nature. That's all I am telling.
The point is that the Bhavata is a concept of how to run a state. Ramayana is a concept of what the state should be. Like Sita, how she should be looked at, how the devotee should sacrifice the human eye, the king should not have places, therefore he is in forest, he should try to equalize with people. These are not actual, these are not realistic. These are the teachings which Ramayana must have gone. But the Ramayana was written basically to portray what kind of state one should have, the Ramraja. And Mahabharata was the concept where how to move the state to bad means, to move people, bad people, murder bhi karo, bhori karo, sab kuch karo, lekin jito.
Finally, five people were left. Where the land meets the sea, and there he showed me a stone which is
yeah, we take one or two questions in case anybody has.
Sir, do you believe in spiritual health and yoga?
Me?
Yeah, Mr. Ran.
I believe in happiness.
And then you say.
That's spiritual.
Pardon? WHO does believe in spiritual health.
Sir, Gujarat Mahaguru to Jamse. Sir, Ishwar ne moto vaignani kito che eva e charcha aapi thi. Amare Gujarati bhajan ma literature festival che tamane khas e bolvani ichha thi. Ema ek kavya pankti ma Ishwar ne vaignani kito che ki Ishwar tu pan che vidna.
When I pray, it simulates the same part of the brain. may feel happy seeing a flower or a beautiful girl or anything like that, good music. So it is all depending on your nature, your swabhava. This is what our old Vaishnavic theories used to say before priests hijacked everything. That's all I am saying.
One sec, I would also like to make a small announcement. Tomorrow there is a parallel activity, travel storytelling workshop, which I am conducting for solo travelers. So if anyone is interested, you can register with the management of the...
See, if even the doctor says that you are sick, having temperature, thermometer says, but my condition in the mind is so energetic that I suppress that physical condition and remain as active as others. In the process of time, I become even normalized. That is the experience. Experience is not to be dominated by others' opinion. Experience is something which is willed from within and that dominates the organs of the body. Remember. And that is how HIV has been proven in the US. Those who have got strong mind, strong confidence, and strong immunity, both the three things, they live longer. HIV does not HIV does not flower into AIDS. It remains HIV, it doesn't get into AIDS. It's the mind which matters a lot, because all the chemicals of the body are ignited, triggered by the mind. And mind destroys and creates, recreates, rejuvenates. So don't ignore the mind, and that mind, satisfaction is one of the elements of mind. If you are satisfied, santushti, you are there, your chromosomes, your hormones are at rest. If you are not satisfied, you get into conflict situation and leading to lot of problems of sickness and ailments.
Thank you so much. May I request Umashankar sir to please felicitate our panel. Mr. Anand Ilgandhan. Mr. Muli Menon. Upper floor, so please do visit. And now I'd like to for the next session.